Hey everyone, welcome to the Dark Blubberhood podcast. My name is Dan. With me today, as always, is Pat.
Hello.
The former king, Mr. Harry Hi-Def.
Hi.
And our Danish princess, no, not Bud. It's our sheepish little mascot, Murray.
Hi.
Yay.
How's everyone doing today?
Suppressing a sneeze during that entire intro. That was a thing.
Well, that's one way to say it.
Oh.
There we go.
The Danish princess. Oh, I like that. That's very cool.
Well, I thought I'd throw that in.
Oh, and according to our other Danish princess, she is a wool-covered whore, but that's another story.
Oh, God, yeah. That was an interesting conversation.
What conversation was this? I missed most of the best conversations.
So this was like 1 a.m. for me. So it was like 2 a.m. for Mary and Bud. And then it's like me and a few of the Americans in TeamSpeak just chilling out. And then Bud comes in. And he is hammered. He is completely drunk. So like we just start talking to him. And it gets like ridiculously funny. Like he starts coming. And then like at times he's reverting to Danish. So I call on Mary to come in and be our interpreter. So as soon as Mary comes in, like she starts asking him questions. And then he says he had 87 drinks or something to that effect.
Oh, God.
Wow.
So, like, he was pretty drunk. And then, like, this goes on for a while where he's insulting everyone. And then at some point, Mary translates something. He gets slightly annoyed by the fact that she's continuing to translate and calls her a wool-covered whore.
But why?
How did that make you feel, Mary?
I don't know.
Fun thing for Dan is I have the entire 45-minute recording on my computer, so you can put that in the link dump. For the podcast.
Oh, yeah. We'll have to do that for sure.
I just want to listen to that and probably spend an hour censoring it out.
I'm super interested in that.
No, you're going to have to put like a little spoiler box on the site and just say, just don't click here, not safe for work. Because...
You know, it's kind of awesome that we have two people who are Danish, that we have one that can translate for us. Madi, I think it's awesome that you can speak two languages. I mean, is that really difficult?
I can speak more than two, actually.
What else can you speak?
German and Spanish, and I know a tiny, tiny amount of French.
Mary is the language princess.
Yeah.
Really? Wow. Okay, so if I were to bring in, like, somebody who spoke a completely different language, like, let's say, from Germany, you'd have a great idea, more or less, of what they're saying?
Yeah, somewhat. I mean, I understand more than I can say, because I haven't had German for 3 years now. I've had Spanish instead. So
you should get Anika in practice.
Oh yeah.
You should talk to Anika in practice.
Yeah, oh yeah, that could be fun actually. But the thing is, in Denmark it's sort of mandatory to have German as a second foreign language. Except if you have like some good reason as to why you can't have German. And then later on in high school and stuff, you can like choose what other foreign language you want to have, whereas English has to be one of them.
You know, it's interesting because in America, there's not really a whole lot of pressure to learn more than one language. I think, I don't want to say it's because...
Going to go ahead and say, in the English-speaking world, that seems to be a trend, because we've got like the Australian guys and the Canadians. The Canadians are like the only ones who want to learn another language, and that's French. Because, you know...
and that's primarily because if you are fluent in French in this country, you have a better chance at getting a good job. Especially in my city, I live in Ottawa, which is our nation's capital. It's right on the border with Quebec, and a lot of government jobs are very much like pro-bilingualism. So if you're fluent in French, you have a better chance of getting a job in the government, which pays a whole lot better than most other crap around here. So for us, it's like, yeah, we want to learn French so that we can get a better job.
What can you say in French, Dan?
Almost anything.
Bonjour.
What was that?
Bonjour.
Bonjour.
Oh, bonjour.
That's Meyer's extent.
That's like, everybody knows bonjour.
Very cool.
See, the thing is, with me in French, I don't, like, I can speak it, but I only reserve it for when I absolutely have to, because I feel like if I'm talking to people who are fluent in French, like it's their first language. I feel like they're judging me on the way I conjugate and my accent and things like that. So I tend to not really, like I said, unless I really have to use it, I just kind of like ask them if they speak English and then go from there.
No, that's smart. Actually, it's very similar because I'm on the border where Mexico is, and there's a lot of pressure in my city to speak Spanish. And over here, there is judgment for how you pronounce things. And because the inflection can mean one thing, and it could mean that you're insulting someone, or they, in other words, there's no sarcasm. You can't really say something in Spanish and be sarcastic if you're not a native of Spanish language, because then anything you say sounds condescending.
Yeah, I have a friend who's from Colombia, and he was telling me one time, we were talking about this same sort of stuff, and he was like, there's one word in Spanish that he was telling me in particular, I can't remember what it was, but depending on how you say it, it's either something really mundane to the effect of, like, pass the butter, or something very, very, very offensive.
Oh, God.
And it was, he spelled it out for me, he's like, this is how you say it this way, this is how you say it this way, and I was like, it's exactly the same. It's just how you say it.
Wow.
And I was like, that would screw me right over. That's why I don't want to learn Spanish.
Mm-hmm. You know, and I can imagine that it's difficult for people who are trying to learn English, because we do that. We have a lot of words that mean two different things sometimes. Like, in slang, we mean something can come and screw me over, or the action of actually screwing a bolt into a door. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah,
as the only non-English native speaker, whatever you call it.
Madi, was it really hard for you to learn German? Is that a hard language to learn?
The thing about German is it's actually kind of easy once you get into it. Also, a lot of the words sound similar to Danish words, so it wasn't that hard, really.
Yeah, because I have a friend who actually lives in Germany right now. He's stationed there with the Air Force, and his girlfriend is German. And I've never heard someone learn German so quickly. So I had to think, wow, either this must be a really attractive girl, or it's not that difficult to learn German.
Yeah, I can imagine that he just tries really hard because she's so attractive.
Yeah, and that's pretty much what happened. He learned enough.
I will learn this language.
Lush filoson signa vespia. Within the first day.
Dude, what?
That's Russian. I got it from a small little snippet of something. Don't.
All right. All right.
Want me to hear me yell in more angry Russian sounds?
I mean, if you want. Insult me if you can.
Bosh, dona eto rasvishua frostowashuk, sweetina moshetvanya.
Da. So for our Russian listeners, enjoy.
Basically, all I did was translate or speak the part that they talked about in Boondock Saints. That's it.
I've never seen that. I have no idea what you're talking about.
Dan, you failed me, Dan. Dan, this is your homework assignment. You need to go rent this movie.
It's never, like, I've seen it around and stuff, and I was like, oh, people talk about that all the time. I should watch it. And then I go, nah. Don't care.
It's a fun watch. If you watch it just as an interesting movie, a lot of people call it a Tarantino clone, all this stuff and all that. So Jurassic World came out this weekend, and Manio, the guy who was supposed to be here, was all excited about that, and he must have gotten so excited he forgot he was supposed to be on the cast today.
I think he ended up staying up really late. I was going to bring that up, too. He posted on Facebook that it made him cry.
Aww.
He was in tears. He enjoyed it so much because he, as he describes it, he is it's his Star Wars, basically, the Jurassic Park franchise.
Wow, okay.
Like, that's what he grew up on. He knows all the little, every character's names, lines from every movie. He's seen every movie multiple times. And, like, he's been waiting for this forever.
Is there a movie, like, that means that much to you, Madi? Like, that's, like, this movie series is my definition of a good time?
Well, there is, I mean, it's a Danish thing,
Of course.
Going to interrupt here quickly. Mine is Harry Potter. Fuck you guys.
So nice, always. Well, it's an old, I guess he's a comedian. He's called Dirk Passer. And he's just, so.
The Deer Tasker? It's okay. I'm sorry. I don't even, yeah.
Yeah. So, yeah. There's a lot of movies, comedies made with him. So yeah, that's basically what I grew up with.
So basically, anything with that guy in it.
Yeah, basically anything with that guy in it was deemed to be great. But I don't I don't know if we have something like Star Wars in that. At least not Danish things.
Right. Well, either way,
I think for me it's
Lord of the Rings.
Oh yeah.
Is it really?
Yeah.
Oh, so this.
When I was in 7th grade, I'll say it like the Americans say it, 7th grade.
Mm-hmm.
You know, every year they make you read a book for whatever. And my teacher decided we were going to read The Hobbit. Mm-hmm. And I was like, oh. When they hand out the books, I'm like, man, this thing's so thick. I don't want to read this crap. And he would do things like, he would go around the room and be like, okay, you start here. And then he'd go through each kid, and each kid would read like a paragraph or two.
Oh, yeah. I remember that.
And so when we started, I'm like, oh, I really don't want this. By like page 10, I was like, hey, can I take this book home? I finished the book in a week. And I'm not a big reader.
Wow.
So in 7th grade, I was like, Dad, gotta buy me a copy. I need this book. So he bought it for me. I read it in like a week. And then every day in class, I was like, is it my turn to read yet? I was so excited for it. And then come to find out that there was actually, you know, the whole Lord of the Rings thing. And I was like, oh, cool. And I started reading those. And then the movie started coming out, and so I've actually never read all three books because the movies came out before I could get to them.
Oh man!
but those were like, I mean, I had them all on DVD. I don't know where they are now, but I would watch them. I'd marathon them, 3-hour movies, like, you know, pretty much your whole day just gone watching three movies.
Wow, that's pretty awesome, dude. That is awesome.
It's like, and the bad thing is, like, I loved, as much as I loved the Lord of the Rings movies, the Hobbit movies, not really a big fan.
Yeah, that's what my wife was telling me. She's a huge Lord of the Rings fan too, and she said that the Hobbit, that they just stretched it out unnecessarily. And
when I heard it was going to be three movies, I was like, how is it going to be three? Like, they made three movies out of three books. The Hobbit's one book.
Mm-hmm.
And then come to see how it's all packaged together, it's like, nah, they just drew it out way too long. Maybe two movies would have been enough.
Mm-hmm.
But they dragged it on too long.
I think most people were excited to see Martin Freeman talking to, oh my God, I can't believe his name is slipping my head right now.
Who?
Sherlock.
Benedict Cumberbatch.
Thank you, Benedict Cumberbatch. He was playing the dragon in the Hobbit series.
And, Smaug?
Yeah, Smaug. Smig. I call him Smig.
I always read it as Smog. And then when the movies were coming out, all the fucking do-gooders were like, "No, it's Smaug."
Yeah. Well, I used to get April mad at me because I'd say it's a desolation of Smig, and she goes, "It's not Smig." It was the funniest thing. But then watching Benedict Cumberbatch talk with Martin Freeman over the coins was like, "Oh, look, it's Sherlock and Watson. This is very cool."
Oh, really? I didn't know that connection.
Yeah. Did you ever, have you ever watched the show called Sherlock?
It's a BBC show.
A TV show,
yeah,
with Lucy Liu?
BBC, yeah. But no, that's Elementary, isn't it?
I think that's Elementary.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
It's a BBC show with Martin Freeman and Benedict Cumberbatch and a bunch of other really cool people. But it's probably the best modern adaptation of Sherlock I've seen in a while. I actually prefer it to the Sherlock Holmes movies. And that's saying something because I'm a huge Robert Downey Jr. fan.
Yeah, the writers or creators behind it wanted it to be the original stories, but in a modern setting.
Yeah.
And they really did a lot for that to be the case.
No, I've never even heard of it, but I was never a big Holmes fan either.
Well, Dan, you got more homework. After you finish Game of Thrones, you have to go watch Sherlock.
Oh, you have no idea. If you were to give me homework on everything I've never seen, I would never, I'd die in a chair.
Right? Yeah.
Like, I've never seen any of the Godfather movies. Goodfellas, I've never seen. I only recently watched Scarface, and I thought it was horrible.
Really?
But that's probably because I watched it in 2015, not 1985 or whenever it was it came out. But, you know, I didn't think it was all that great of a movie.
You know, I haven't seen it either, so I don't feel like I'm at liberty to comment on it. I just know it's a very cult, it has a large cult following behind it. And it's
yeah,
You know, and I don't want to mess with the people who like that movie too much because emulation and all that fun stuff.
All my friends at work, I used to get that all the time. They'd start talking about movies like that. And, you know, oh, you remember in Godfather 2 when this happened? I'm like, no. Well, what do you mean? I was like, I've never seen Godfather. And they just lose it on me. Like, how can you never seen it? It's one of the greatest movies ever. I'm like, I don't know. I watch what I like, and it's mostly comedy, so I don't watch stuff like that.
Well, that's cool. You know, my favorite movie is Ghostbusters.
Oh, great movie.
Yep.
Ghostbusters 2, not so much.
I can't help but follow everything that Bill Murray does. He's definitely one of my favorite comedians.
Okay, so your favorite movie is Ghostbusters. So how do you feel about the new one that's coming out with the all-female cast?
Here's how I feel. I made a video about this for the other podcast that I do. Okay, when they decided to make an all-female cast, I want to believe that they did it because they felt like they could expand on the comedy that was limited to them because the previous cast was all males. So mm-hmm. I think, okay, here's a creative decision that, hey, we can expand our comedy because now we can include the female demographic and have their relation to everything that happened to them. But then, you know, I observe things like I feel like it's more of a marketing ploy than it is essential to the addition of the story.
So I'll ask this then, because this seems to be the issue more than the fact that it's an all-female cast.
Mm-hmm.
The issue that most people have with it, I'm finding, is one actress in particular. Do you know who I'm talking about?
Are you talking about Melissa McCarthy?
Yes.
What of her?
It seems to be that she's the major problem with the female cast. For whatever reason, I guess most people that I've talked to anyway, I'm not saying this is a general consensus across the world,
mm-hmm.
but most people that I've talked to about this, they say that they're okay with the female cast, just they wish that she wasn't in it.
Huh.
And I don't know where that's coming from because I haven't watched hardly anything with her in it, so I don't have an opinion on her acting, but I mean, what's the issue with her?
You know, I see where this point comes from, but I think a lot of that has to do with ignorance because she does come from a comedy that's a little bit more heavy, a little bit more raunchy, I guess you could say. But, I mean, she was handpicked by Bill Murray. They did that movie, right. St. Vincent, together, and he's given her his blessing, which is his way of saying, hey, she's funny. And I guess, to me, the person that I respect that much as a comedian, for him to say, hey, she's funny, that's like, holy crap, I want to absolutely see what she has to offer. I think it's too unfair, man or woman, to judge a movie before it's come out. I mean, look at what happened with Heath Ledger and The Dark Knight. Everybody hated the fact that he was being picked as the Joker, and then the movie came out, and then suddenly he was the greatest actor of all time. You know, so
I think the same thing's going to end up happening with Ben Affleck, right? Like, you saw the major uproar when he was announced as the next Batman.
Uh-huh.
I think he'll do okay. And I think it'll kind of all go away, like, once it comes out. I think it'll be a good enough movie, and he'll perform well enough that it'll kind of silence the naysayers, so to speak. Because
mm-hmm.
there was a lot of outrage over him being chosen as Batman. Like, I mean, ultimately, it's not your choice, you know?
Well, it's not even so much that, but, I mean, it's like saying, you know, how can you possibly judge a guy's performance before he's actually had the chance to perform? I mean, you could take a role like, I think more often it's easier to say a role that's beneath someone as opposed to a role that's above someone. Like, I don't think it's fair to say a role is above anyone because usually a director picked that person for a purpose and they're a director for a reason. They have the creative ambition to do that. But you know, picking Vin Diesel to be the Tooth Fairy, I mean, yeah, that you can say safely. That was a role that was, you know, he probably should have stayed away from. But hey, why not? That's fine.
But then they followed that up with Larry the Cable Guy in Tooth Fairy 2. So, I mean, in for that movie franchise anyway, it went from bad to worse, so to speak. Like, I love Larry the Cable Guy. I think he's a hilarious comedian, but he was just god-awful in that movie.
Indeed, indeed. You know, Marty, there's a question that we had asked everybody else who had been on the podcast, and I think it was how they came to find the Dark Blubberhood server. Do you remember how you joined up?
Yeah, well, it was, I had joined the RT site, and then forgotten about it for a couple of months. Then I heard about them doing Cards Against Humanity, and I thought, dear God, I want to watch that. I want to watch it. But I realized that that was sponsor content, and then yeah, so I just decided to sponsor, and then I went into the forum and I fell over the forum post for the server. And yeah, so basically, I wanted in, and my first day was the last time we did Thunderdome. I don't know if that's been the only time, but that was like my first day here, and I did not have TeamSpeak up. I did not know how to set it up, so I was like in the middle of everything and not having any idea what was going on really. But
Oh, that's
that's
cool.
cool. Yeah, but
We always ask like why, I mean, not why, but like when people join, their first experience is usually Harry rushing to them to murder them ruthlessly. But did you ever feel like Harry was a negative experience or a negative presence on the server?
Not really. I mean, it went a while before I actually met Harry. But I thought it was like, all right, he killed me a couple of times, but I was like, dude, what the fuck? And then we started this small war.
Nice. Fire
So,
back.
yeah, just
I like it.
so but no, I not really as a negative thing. I mean, he has his traditions, and I was just, yeah, let him do it.
You see, my goal is slowly over the course of these podcasts is to start peeling away Harry's persona to reveal him to be a nice, cuddly teddy bear.
He is a nice cuddly teddy bear when you like talk to him without
He
mentioning.
can be. He I think he likes to come off as like the mean guy to new people.
Yeah.
But you quickly find out the
Established
more you
dominance.
hang around. Yeah, it's sort of the alpha male sort of thing. But the more you hang around him, you realize, hey, he's a pretty nice guy.
Also, I think he loves the fact that he speaks with that heavy Scottish accent, and there's these online videos of people who go and actually troll people for the fun of it that speak this heavy Scottish accent, and it's hilarious to hear them screaming whenever they get
Yeah.
angry. So I think he's in love with his own accent, and he just loves just giving people a hard time.
That reminds me of a video I saw. It's like a Scottish guy trying to play guitar, and he keeps screwing up and he curses like crazy. It's the funniest thing. If I can find it, I'll put it in the link dump. I haven't seen it in a while, but it was so funny when I first saw it.
Oh, hey, not but to jump back to movies real quickly. I okay, as a Lord of the Rings fan, how are you doing after this announcement that Christopher Lee passed away?
Oh.
I mean, I didn't know the guy personally. I mean, it's always, sad when an actor that you came to really enjoy passes away, but I look at it in this light. The man was 93.
Yeah.
He lived a full life. You know what I mean?
No, you're right. You're right.
I lost my grandfather about a year and a half ago, and he was also 93. And yeah, it was sad to lose him, but 93 years of life—that's more than a lot of people get. And I think what Christopher Lee did in his 93 years. I mean, you don't really have to mourn for the guy because you didn't, like I said, I didn't know him personally. So it's not like I sat there and cried or anything. But I was like, oh, damn, that kind of sucks that there's, if they decide to do something else in the Lord of the Rings universe somehow, that he won't be around or he won't be a part of it. But at the same time, like, but he was 93 years old and still acting and putting out metal records and, all this stuff. So I'm like, he was a kick-ass dude and it sucks that he's gone. But again, 93.
Yeah. I think it's kind of the same thing that happened. Well, I don't want to say it's the same thing that happened, but you know how you say that, oh yeah, I didn't know the guy personally, but you feel that the impact of his loss, I guess. He was also in Star Wars, the original movies, and he's probably the only parts of those movies that was somewhat tolerable. And he was he's just a brilliant actor, and he was he, like you said, he lived a full life, he did an amazing job. It's sad, like you said, to see someone that you have this admiration for finally, call it in, and it's like, oh, doggone it.
Yeah, and the thing too is, when you look at it, like I said, he was alive for 93 years. He got a lot accomplished, and I don't think there's much more that he could have done to enrich his life further. Whereas, with tragedies like Heath Ledger, Robin Williams, that one hurt particularly for me, partially because he was in almost every kid's movie that I ever watched growing up, but also because you realize, I mean, he was in his 50s, something like that.
Yeah.
You know, he could have still contributed a lot of entertainment had he not passed away when he did. So, I mean, things like when great actors die younger, it's a lot harder to stomach than if somebody like Christopher Lee passes away. It's, you know, it's his time, sort of.
No,
so, I mean, I kind of look at it that way.
Yeah. Yeah, I think that's a really brilliant way of looking at it, is it's just the relevance that they have to their age and how much they've accomplished. Christopher Lee certainly did contribute as much as he possibly could. I'm kind of thinking that they're lucky, or were lucky, that he was able to get in the Hobbit movies. And
yeah, absolutely.
Because how close was it that he wasn't able to do that? I mean, it was like a span of a couple of years that they did the release of the last movie. So it's sad, but yeah, it's kind of depressing. I don't want this to be the depressing portion of our podcast here. But one more.
That happens.
Another person that I kind of feel like I want to mention in this is Monty. When he passed away, that was probably a lot harder to handle. And it's weird because, like you said, you don't know the person personally, but you understand how amazing that person was and the potential that he had in him if only he had more time. And it's like, oh man, that was a sucker punch to the gut that I don't think... And people who
For Monty, like Monty, I actually almost cried.
Yeah.
When I heard, like... When they first put the post up that he was in critical care in the hospital, my heart was racing. I was sitting here at home,
yeah,
and my heart was racing. I'm like, why am I so panicked? I don't even know this guy. And then they put out the release that he had passed away, and I almost cried. And I was like, I don't even know the guy. But through the interviews that he's put out, or, you know, being on the podcasts for Rooster Teeth, or, you know, just the content he put out, I guess he had more of a connection with his audience personally than, let's say, Christopher Lee did.
Yeah. Well, I mean, and then, and obviously
maybe that's the media. Like, I don't know if it's, you know, because Monty was doing internet content, and I don't know, we just feel a more personal connection with Rooster Teeth or what, but it seemed to Monty was like losing a friend. Whether you knew him or not, which is kind of weird.
Well, you know what it is? And I don't even see it in the same context as not having known him personally. Like, you're right, I never spoke with him. But it's more like, here's this guy that you know loves life. He was in love with life. And he loved creating things. He loved working hard for them. He gave his 100% all the time. And it's just seeing how excited he was to do the things that he wanted to do. And it was inspiring. I mean, it was contagious. The way he would talk about his projects, the way he would talk about his coworkers, the way he would shut himself in a room for an entire convention just to work on Ruby or whatever. I mean, you saw how much potential, not potential, because he was already lived up his potential, but he, you know, to see him cut short in his life, I think that's what was the most depressing, is like you sympathized for him because you wanted him to have more. He deserved more than what he had. And he had a lot.
Yeah.
But it's like you wanted so much more for him. So to see him being cut back, that's what was depressing, I think, to me and to most other people who like to think of themselves as, air quote, artists. You know what I mean? We have our ideas of what we think is art. And then we see someone like Monty Ohm, who completely obliterates the modern conventions of needing to go to college and having to get certain structured lessons in order to learn a craft. He did it all on his own. He developed it all on his own, and all he did was just work his, you know, ass off. And look at what he's accomplished. And that's an example of someone who I probably felt heavier loss from, and not because I knew him, but because of how much of who he was and relating to where, you know, he wanted to be and how hard he had to have worked to gotten where he was. You know what I mean?
Yeah. As a well, let's call it an air quote musician. there's something in the music industry that they call, pardon me, that I'm not sure you're aware of. They call it the curse of the 27.
Yeah.
Okay.
So it's several famous musicians who have died at the age of 27. I always get this wrong. I want to say Janis Joplin, but I don't remember if she's dead or not.
I would have to look it up. Yeah, it sounds right though.
Anyway, Jimi Hendrix, Kurt Cobain, somebody in the Buddy Holly accident. There was one of them. He was pretty famous. He was only 27. Amy Winehouse, who, you know, it may not have been your style of music per se, but you had to admit the talent that she had. Like, her singing voice was incredible. She was 27 when she died.
Wow.
So there's this belief that, well, I don't know if it's a belief, but this is something that people say, like, the brightest stars burn out quicker.
Yeah.
And, you know, like, if you could imagine how much of an impact Jimi Hendrix was in the 60s and 70s, or whenever it was he died. I think it was in the 70s. But if you can imagine how much of an impact he had in the, like, 6 or 7 years he was famous, try to imagine if he'd stayed alive.
Yeah, you're right.
You know what I mean? Like, how different would music be today? Same with Nirvana, if they were still around today, if Kurt hadn't died. You know, all that, like, the major, major influences, great songwriters, things like that, would have changed the landscape drastically from where it is now.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But sometimes it seems that the people with the most talent don't live as long. And Monty could be, you know, grouped in with that. I mean, he wasn't 27. He was, what, 33?
Yeah, he was 33.
But still, very young. And he had so much more to offer the world. But unfortunately, he's not going to get the chance to show that. But, you know what I mean? I think it'll be interesting to see how Ruby develops without him. If they'll keep it going. If it'll be as good.
I think they definitely have the potential to be able to do that. Madi, did you have any like reaction to how, when Monty passed?
I think ultimately I was kind of shocked. Like, wait, what? Sort of reaction.
Just kind of a sudden thing that happened, huh?
But I just felt like because I've never. What do you call it? I don't know. But I sort of feel like my first thoughts went to, like, the rest of Rooster Teeth, because all the work Monty's done and all the things he helped get up and running and change. I sort of feel like what's gonna happen? I mean, how are they gonna take it? But it wasn't really until was it Mick who made, like, the no for it, about it? And you could just see, like, she's barely holding on. Like, she's just about to break down crying.
Yeah. That was hard to watch.
That was really, and I started crying after that. I literally started crying.
Yeah.
Yeah, I had a hard time holding it back watching that video, too. Like, I don't understand why it was Meg.
I think it was
Meg. Or was it Meg or was it Ashley? I think it was Meg. I don't understand why they had Meg do it. And not for anything against Meg. It just seems like she was the newest face to Rooster Teeth. So, I mean, I can't say how well she knew Monty or anything. But you know what I mean? Like, there's other people in the company that perhaps could have made that.
You know, at the time.
Made that announcement. But I think coming from Meg, it was a little bit easier to take, because you can see how broken up she was.
Yeah.
And, like, if it had been Gus or Bernie or something, like, I don't even think they could have got through it and got the video up, you know?
Yeah. You know, I kind of think that's what happened, is that Meg probably was the only one able to coherently explain what was going on, because anybody else probably would have broken down crying at that time.
Yeah, that makes sense. Well, when you watch the podcast that they put out, where it was Gus and Bernie and Matt and Gray.
Yeah.
Just, you know, telling stories about Monty and stuff. Like, it was weird to me, but it was also heartwarming to me to see Gus almost cry several times.
Yeah.
Like, as weird as that sounds, like, you know, he comes off as just like the total, like, I don't give a shit kind of guy.
Mm-hmm.
And then you'd see him tell a story, and mid-story he'd get choked up. And he was very good at holding it back, but it was, I don't know. There was something about that podcast that I really enjoyed.
You know, I think it's something very healthy for the audiences that they have to see, because a lot of times people forget that, you know, Bernie, Jeff, Gus, even the newer crowd, Gavin and all them. Oh, I call them newer, yet they're pretty aged now. They put on personas. kind of like when we're playing a video game where we're doing stuff, you know, Harry's Harry. That's the whole concept, is that the thing that Harry's doing is a persona that he puts on for people to, you know, have fun and play around. And Gus, he plays the mean, cold-hearted Grinch. He's like the Grinch in summer, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And but he is actually a real person who actually has to deal with real frustrating things. And the thing that is awesome across the board with Rooster Teeth, as far as at least I can recognize, is that they're in love with their fans. Bernie probably more so than anybody else. It's funny because his phone was ringing during a podcast, and he's like, "Oh, I'm real sorry about that. I'm real sorry about that." And then it happened again, and you could tell it bothered him so much that he was interrupting this production that he just threw his phone. He was like, "No, screw that. I'm done with it." And it was so subtle, and it was so little bit, but it was like you see how much they honestly care about their fans, because they realize that they wouldn't be where they are if it wasn't for people who actually took that interest in them.
Yeah, but that's very true.
It was so good for them to see, especially Bernie, like, well, because Bernie is pretty much Bernie. He's not really a whole lot different than who he really is. But like someone like Gus, to see the human side of him, or to see Jeff's human side, where they're not the alcoholic, you know, lazy guy. They're actually real people that experience these real heavy things. And that kind of gives you an appreciation for the job they do, because even though Monty passed, you know, the next day they had to get up, they had to go to work, and they still had to do it again. And
for sure.
It's like, ouch. You gain a whole new respect for them in addition to the entertainment value they give you.
Yeah.
All right. Let's move away from this.
Okay.
Just we've respected the people who have passed away.
No,
it's totally cool. It's where the conversation flowed. I just think we should get away from it now.
Excellent point.
So a question that I've wanted to ask you, Mary, for a while now. I've been seeing posts about you possibly coming to the States. What's that all about? Is that a permanent thing? Is that a visit? Are you looking to move there? Or?
Well, I'm going there to be an au pair in Ohio. And I'm going to be there for a year to begin with. And then like towards the end of that year, I can see if I want to expand or if I want to stay another year or so.
Okay, but it's not something you're looking to do permanently? Like you're not looking to move
to the US?
That
really depends. I mean, everyone around me here at home is like joking about, well, she's never coming back home, and but it all depends on like the feeling I get from the US. I've never been there before, so I mean, in Denmark we sort of have this stereotype about Americans, and like that it's not really that great to live there, but it's something I feel like I get a great look at. So it all depends. It could be really awesome because
okay. So it's not definite that you're staying, but it's not.
No, it's not.
Possibility.
It's
Well, that's cool.
Let's see where it goes.
I think you'll enjoy it. I really do. You know, the thing about the States is that we're. It's so weird. We have so many stereotypes across the states. It's unbelievable. Like the way people perceive people who are in Texas, as opposed to people that perceive people who are from Brooklyn, as opposed to people who perceive people who are from California. Mm-hmm. I hate to say it, but most of those stereotypes are pretty dead on. Like you'll come to Texas, you'll see a guy wearing a cowboy hat, riding a horse somehow. You'll be in the middle of one of the most urban, you know, fitted areas, or you'll be in the most metro city area, and there's still going to be some guy walking around in a cowboy hat. But, you know, I really do. We got a lot of great drinks here, Monty. I don't know if you know that. They got rum everywhere. And the bars here are really good. They got great prices. They got happy hour. The States is a pretty good place to be. Dan, please.
There you go. This message endorsed by Pat. So on another note, we have E3 starting this week. Is there anything you guys are looking forward to about this E3?
You know, I want to see that virtual reality actually is going to be a valuable form of gaming.
Yeah, I know we were talking about that in the forum the other day.
Yeah, and it's not like I'm trying to say who's going to have the better VR technology. The whole genre of VR gaming is a huge deal to me, because I love making animations. So the idea that I could see those animations interacting with a real life scenario, like the HoloLens,
mm-hmm.
To me, that was such an awesome concept that you could just put on these glasses and boom, you're playing a game right there in your living room, or you could create a Netflix screen on your wall and then turn it up and then boom, there's your screen.
Yeah, that'd be pretty cool.
So I'm excited about
that. I don't really care about anything.
At all?
I think whatever, like, there's nothing I'm looking forward to. I think if anything comes out that I'm like, oh, hey, that's cool, that'll be that. But I'm not, like, foaming at the mouth for, like, Fallout 4, which I know has already been announced. But, you know, things like that. Like, there's nothing that I'm really craving. Unfortunately,
Mary
has
to
just
go.
Informed me that she has to leave.
Oh, okay.
Okay, well, it's been
fun.
A slice having you on.
So, thank you.
We appreciate it. Maybe we'll have you on again, but for now, we shall say goodbye and let you go.
Bye.
For now, Maddie, we'll see you later. I have a tear in my eye. It's falling onto the chair.
Bye.
Bye. Take care, Mary.
But yeah.
All right. So we're down to just me and Pat. So going back to E3, and your point, I think VR is something that I, like you, really hope takes off, because I think it could be a really cool next medium. But for me, with Oculus in particular,
mm-hmm.
it's a little pricey for the initial setup.
Oh, yeah.
And, like, I know there's other setups out there that I don't know if they're necessarily as good, because I haven't got too far into the specs, but I know there's other things out there that are cheaper. And, you know, hopefully they can get it down to a manageable price point where it's not, you know, something like when a new next-gen console releases, you're looking to spend, you know, $500-$600. Mm-hmm. Hopefully it's not something like that. Hopefully they can get it down to something where it's maybe just an add-on.
Mm-hmm.
And then we get, you know, VR-supported games, stuff like that. Like, I think that would be good. But to be a console on its own, let's say,
mm-hmm.
I don't know if that can really work.
Well, I mean, I think, like you said, almost like an add-on where you have the capabilities of connecting it to, let's say, a laptop or your existing gaming console, and then you're able to download or purchase games that mm-hmm. interact with you on a, you know, on a wireless basis. But I think where I'm concerned is that you have a system that potentially has so many expectations. So there's not – the way that I would want it to work is not going to be the same way, let's say, Shelley would want it to work, or the same way that Dark would want it to work, or the way that Drew would want it to work. They may think it's all these different things. So ultimately, I think there's going to be a lot of letdown initially, because the way that we're going to receive it is the way that the distributor wants it to work. And
that's true.
I don't really see it taking off right away, but I do. I don't want that to be the, you know, the nail in the coffin for the genre of VR gaming. Because I see the potential in it. How cool it would... I don't know if you've seen this thing that JJ, who used to do the screenplay podcast on Rooster Teeth and is now doing the Film Geek Army podcast, has this video on YouTube, and it's called Move 360. And essentially, it's a functionality on, I think, a mobile device or any device that supports the 360 technology, where you can look at the YouTube video and look around the room that's created inside this YouTube thing. I'll send you the link.
And I've heard about it.
It's amazing. It is amazing. And there's one there that's for, like, this haunted house thing made by somebody else. And I'll link you that as well. And I think with the proper immersion technology, like like an Oculus Rift, but not the price, and a good sound system, like a good set of quality headphones, you could trick your brain into thinking you're in this different area.
I think it's possible. I know they were, and I don't remember what the system was. I don't know if it was the Oculus. I don't remember, but I remember seeing something. It was another VR-type headset, but it came with, like, a walking base.
Uh-huh.
Where it was basically, like, a bunch of treadmills or something like that. It was, like, a little circle that you stand in so that you actually, if you're playing a shooter, you actually have to walk, and it moves your character.
Yeah.
And I thought, that is really friggin' cool.
Mm-hmm.
That they can do that, but at the same time, you know, who has that much room
and not
in
only,
their house or
and
something
not only
like that?
But
and
go ahead,
you know, I just don't see, like, it was a really cool idea, but it's like functionality, I don't know. But a headset alone to be able to just throw it on your face, stand in the middle of your living room or even sit in your living room and be able to have that sort of same functionality, but maybe with a controller to move your character.
Mm-hmm.
That's a little more feasible to me, but it's still cool that they were able to do that.
You know, it is. And I think if they went too far with the treadmill, like, we're not there yet.
Yeah.
We're not there yet. People aren't going to want to do that, because I think even Bernie on a podcast once was talking about how he did something to where when he ran on his treadmill, it would move his World of Warcraft character. And just the run to the next town, it exhausted him. So he was like, forget it. I'm not going to do this. And that's exactly the problem. Video games are, I hate to say it, they tend to become popular with couch potatoes or people who want to sit down and enjoy it. I mean, can you imagine Gus trying to play a game where he's, you know, trying to figure out how to move from one city to the other? No, he'd say, screw this. I'm not going to play that.
And oh, yeah, he absolutely would.
And I'm of the same opinion. Now, if I saw them make these small little, like, hand ring things that you put on both hands, and they kind of, like, have the triggers on them, and then that would act as a wireless controller to your Oculus Rift or to your VR headset, and that would allow you to move forward kind of like you would a controller. And since they're separate and they're wireless, let's say that you look to the right, you want to shoot something on the right, like a FPS, then there you go. You have that virtual experience without the overabundance of, you know, interactivity and all that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, they have the potential to do it correctly. That's what freaks me out the most, is that they have the potential to do it correctly. I just want to see it done right. And then there was this one video I saw on YouTube of this guy that gave me hope, which was he went into an E3 booth. They put on the Oculus Rift. They put the sound on, and it's like Batman Arkham Asylum. And he's standing mm-hmm. on top of a rooftop, and he's staring down. He says you can see all of Gotham just from that rooftop, like you're Batman. And he goes, even though I knew I was standing in a room, I was scared to take that extra step forward because I was afraid I was going to fall off the building, you know?
Yeah. I know there was, I don't know if it was E3 last year, but there was this big thing about, it was something with the Oculus, and I don't know if it was a game or if it was just a video sequence, but it was of the wall from Game of Thrones.
Uh-huh.
And, like, you're standing on top of the wall looking down.
Uh-huh.
And I guess they had fans in the room, so it's like the wind's blowing in your hair, and it feels cool like it would up on top of the wall. And I thought, I would love to do that.
Absolutely.
Just experience that, because I love Game of Thrones. I would love to have that experience where it's like, I'm standing on top of the wall.
Yep.
You know, I thought it would be so awesome.
It's definitely on its way. I mean, I think we give it a couple more years, it's going to be this very purchasable device. Because, you know, our brains, human brains, do a lot of the work for you. They, you know, like when you're in a dream and you taste something and you know, wait a minute, it's a dream. I couldn't have possibly have eaten that potato chip, right? But you tasted it in the dream. So I think with enough visual stimulus, our brains will make up the remainder of the illusion, thus making virtual reality really freaking amazing.
Yeah, so I guess the point here on VR is that we're both pretty much excited about it,
mm-hmm.
but they need to take their time and do it properly.
I agree.
Don't rush it. I mean, I know E3 is not generally something where they announce things and it happens later that year.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it could be just a thing like, hey, this is where we're at now. We're going to refine it over the next couple years, and hopefully they can get it out.
Agreed.
So the last thing I want to get to before we wrap up here, I know we've kind of dwindled from four people down to two, but for those of you listening that are part of the Blubberhood, I think it's really cool. There's this thing going on lately where the creativity in the group and the willingness to create content has really ramped up since we started the podcast. And I don't know if it's because we've started the podcast or it's because people are, you know, finishing up their school terms and now they have more time to do things and they're more willing to do things. But we've got a lot of cool stuff going on with our server right now. Manio, I wish he was here because he could talk more about it, but he has fallen in love with streaming.
Mm-hmm.
So he's been doing a lot of that stuff. He did Far Cry 4 co-op with Harry. Most recently, he got Lego Jurassic World. He's been doing that. Dale has been trying to organize things where we just start playing different games, and whether or not we stream them, record them, whatever. You know, he was very much into doing something like that. So we've started Halo Nights. We've started a guild in Neverwinter. There's so much...
There's so much to do.
Possibility for content coming out right now. And I think it's really awesome. And I don't know, like I said, I don't know if it's because we started the podcast or it's just a timing thing. Mm-hmm. But I think over the next little while, it's a pretty exciting time in the Blubberhood.
I agree with you. And honestly, I think it's that the talent was always there. The energy was almost there, was always there. The issue is always, is there an audience for it? And I really feel like for the first time, we have our audience, which is basically each other. We enjoy the silly things that we do. So, of course, we're going to love the silly productions we're making. And we have real-time feedback to kind of say, hey, this is going well. This is going well. Maybe we should do this, this, and whatever. And it's awesome. I personally love it. And it's like the more time goes on, I really fall more in love with the Blubberhood concept because we have this group of people who are willing to support one another in order to create, you know, whatever it is that they wanted.
And yeah, it's really, like I said, it's really cool. Like, everybody's coming up with ideas now. Hey, I want to do this. I'm thinking about doing that. Anybody interested in doing this? And the response to every single thing is there's always someone there going, yeah, I'll do it. I'll help you out with this. I'll do that. So there's, you know, I just love that there's no real negativity like, oh, what a stupid idea. Why would you want to do that? It's always like, hey, I'm interested. I'll be in it, you know?
Absolutely, absolutely. You know, and then I think what the biggest issue with what – it's kind of like what happened with Gus when, and I know I keep referencing Rooster Teeth in this, but he told a really funny story where he was at a bar at 11 a.m. in the morning, and there was a bunch of people around the bar, but nobody went to go get a drink. So he said, screw it, I'm just going to go get a drink, you know? Mm-hmm. So he went up and he decided, I'm gonna get a drink right now. And after he did, everybody got in line and started ordering drinks. And and it's like, he didn't care about it. He just wanted to have fun. He was whatever.
I guess that's a group mentality thing. It takes one person to jump up, and then everybody else will inevitably follow suit.
Yeah, because they want to see that nobody, you're not going to be scrutinized because you did something that stood out. And that's what I love about the era of the community that the Blubberhood represents, is that have fun. If you feel like you want to create something, do it. I mean, matter of fact, right now we're looking for music to be part of the podcast intro. So if any of you musicians out there want to add something to the beginning of it, submit it to us, and we'll see if we can't work you in there. But
I know for sure we've gotten Keller.
Oh, really?
I know he's been trying to get a hold of me the last couple days to talk about something. So we've already got at least one person who's going to be doing theme songs. And I don't know if we can try and maybe work it into a prize somehow, maybe a shirt from the Rooster Teeth store or...
maybe a Blubberhood t-shirt from the Blubberhood store.
Maybe. It's just something. I'm not going to say that we're having a competition, but if we get enough submissions, maybe we could do something where we will eventually pick the permanent theme song for the podcast, and if it's yours, you know, you can
we will write you a very
as we decide. I'll write you a lovely handwritten letter and mail it to you.
All right, that's man. That's pretty cool. I love all that.
Well, I think we're at time to wrap up, so I want to thank everyone for joining us today. Don't forget, this podcast is available for download on iTunes as well as our Blogspot page, darkblubberhood.blogspot.ca. You can also like us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter at Dark Blubberhood, as well as you can find our personal Twitters if you want to follow us as well. So thanks for listening, and we'll see you next time. Bye, everybody.
Bye.